Hello everybody and welcome back to my channel and welcome to part 4 of the Manson family video. Before we get started, I wanted to take a quick moment and talk about our sponsor for this video, and it's Ana Luisa Jewelry. So last week I was doing a video and I was wearing a silver necklace, and I had a bunch of people ask where I got the necklace from. And our sponsor for this video is Ana Luisa Jewelry, and that's where I got the necklace from. This necklace that I'm wearing today is also from Ana Luisa, but the one I wore last week that I got a lot of comments on was this guy here. And I actually picked this necklace because it reminded me of a colada ring. I used to wear a colada ring all the time in high school, and it just had some really good memories for me. I'm not a person that minds mixing gold and silver jewelry. My earrings are silver, my rings are silver, but my necklace that I'm wearing today from Ana Luisa is gold. I know a lot of people think it's a no-no in the fashion industry to mix silver and gold jewelry, but I've always marched to the beat of my own drum, so I do it. Ana Luisa has some of the coolest, most unique pieces of jewelry that I've seen in a while. There's this honeycomb necklace that I really want, but they've been sold out because it's so popular, so I can't wait to get it. More important than that, though, is the material that the pieces are made out of. Are they gonna last? If you purchase a piece of jewelry from this company, is it gonna be something that stays in your collection for a while? Something you can pass down to your daughter or your grandkids? And I would say with absolute certainty that these pieces are made to last. They use only 14 karat solid gold that won't oxidize or tarnish, and the sterling silver that they use in their pieces is 92.5% is silver. What I really loved about Ana Luisa, though, is that they are a sustainable brand. It takes 20 tons of earth mining to make a single ring of gold. And that's why Ana Luisa uses only 100% recycled gold in their jewelry. And I really like that. I think it's important to understand that we live on a planet that has a lot to offer, but if we keep using it and using it and using it, it won't have a lot to offer for very long. This stuff really holds up. I've had it for over a month now, and I wanted to see, you know, can I shower with it? I brought it to Mexico with me. Is it going to be an issue if I go swimming with it? Is it going to travel well? Is it gonna get all tangled? Is it going to scratch or tarnish when it's in my carry-on? And they really ended up traveling beautifully with me. I wear them in the shower, I wore them in the pool, I wore them in the ocean. They didn't scratch when they traveled with me, even though I kind of just threw everything into one pouch and I should have been more careful, but they held up really well. I have another piece here that I really liked. It's really dainty, but it also has this really pretty stone in the middle that sets it out and kind of makes it a little bit of a standout piece when you're wearing it. It looks different than anything I've ever seen anywhere. The pricing on these pieces, I believe, is very reasonable. You go to a jewelry store like Zales or Tiffany's, you're gonna pay such a huge retail markup. And with Ana Luisa, they're cutting out the middleman, they're cutting out all of that retail markup. So you get really beautiful high-end pieces for a very affordable price. And they do offer a complimentary one-year warranty on every piece that they sell, so you're covered as far as that goes. It's kind of been my mission to start trying to accessorize a little bit more. For so many years since Bella was born, it's been really kind of laid back for me because it feels like anything I wear, especially when she was a baby, she's always grabbing at it, breaking it, or, you know, scratching herself with it. So now that she's getting older, she's about 2.5, I feel like I can, you know, bring that back into my wardrobe, bring that back into my style, and I'm really excited to have Ana Luisa be a part of that. If you guys are interested in checking out their jewelry, the link is in the description box, and you can use the code Sleuthany10 for $10 off your first purchase. Thank you guys so much for listening. You know I always appreciate you, and you know how important sponsorships are, especially to this channel, because we are often demonetized for the nature of the things that we talk about, which is why I always seek out and accept sponsorships that I actually do believe in and, you know, actually use the product. I would never, ever suggest something to you guys that I didn't 100% believe in. Let's get started on part 4 of the Manson family video. And at this point, guys, I could tell you, oh, you know, this is the last part, or oh, there's gonna be another part, but I've given up trying to figure out how many parts there are going to be. So I hope you're here on this wild ride for me. This has never happened to me before. Usually I can kind of guess or predict how many parts that there will be, but there's just so much more that I find as I'm going through this, and I'm just gonna let it be what it is. I'm just gonna let it naturally evolve into however many parts it feels it needs to be. So hopefully you'll hang in with me for all of them, because at this point, I can't back out. I can't stop now. I have dedicated myself to seeing this through in the best way that I know how, and the only way that I know how, and I can't stop. Charlie had moved the family back to Spawn Ranch full-time by late February, and he'd sent Squeaky, or Lynette, from ahead to sort of smooth old George Spahn out before their arrival. George hadn't been happy with their previous stints at the ranch, but she somehow managed to convince him into letting them come back, so they did. Manson also made sure to tell Lynette that she should try to weasel her way into George's will. Guy was old, and when he died, if Lynette was in his will, Spahn Ranch would become the property of the Manson family, and they wouldn't have to ever worry about anybody asking them to leave or running them off again. He also sent a couple of people over to Barker Ranch in Death Valley. Barker Ranch had been made known to Manson in November of 1968 when he and some of the family had been staying in nearby Myers Ranch, which belonged to the grandmother of one of the members, Catherine Gillies. Myers Ranch was not in great shape and wasn't big enough to hold all of them, so they migrated to nearby Barker Ranch and began setting up a base there. Manson told the elderly owner, Arlene Barker, that they were a group of musicians and they needed a place to rehearse and practice. In order to prove their legitimacy and to give Arlene Barker some sort of payment, Charlie Manson gave her a gold Beatles album that they'd stolen from Dennis Wilson's house. Barker Ranch was where Manson planned to bring the family when Helter Skelter started. When shit hit the fan, Barker Ranch in Death Valley, very remote, very far out there. Like, you thought Spahn Ranch was bad, you thought Spahn Ranch was kind of remote, Barker Ranch was even worse. It was built in the 1930s and used in the 1940s as a part of a mining operation, and you basically would get your water from a creek nearby, and the only electricity that you had access to was from a windmill, and it really didn't provide a good source of electricity. So essentially, they would be living in a very remote, very hard to find area. You would have to drive a very long time to get back to civilization. And people really weren't too happy about it. They had come from Dennis Wilson's mansion to Spahn Ranch, which, you know, it wasn't a mansion, but at least it was kind of fun. And now Charlie wanted them to, you know, eventually end up in Barker Ranch, which was literally the middle of nowhere. But Charlie told them that this was where the bottomless pit was, in Death Valley, somewhere nearby. The bottomless pit with the enchanted city underneath could be found. They needed to prepare for the coming war. The cities were going to be absolutely outrageous and full of violence and death, so they couldn't be there. They had to be in the middle of nowhere. They had to be at Barker Ranch in the middle of Death Valley, where the bottomless pit was located. And one of their jobs when they were at Barker was to find the bottomless pit. They also had to learn to survive in the desert. They had to carry a knife with them at all times for protection and learn how to walk across the sand without leaving footprints. One of their jobs was to scout places between Spahn and Barker Ranch where they could hide food stores and the dune buggies. Guys, the dune buggies. This is... You can't make this up. Charlie and his family would steal VWs, bugs, and the occasional Porsche, and basically rip them apart and turn them into a vehicle that could function in the desert, because normal cars couldn't. There was too much sand, there was too much rough terrain. You had to have a dune buggy. So in order to make sure that he could get everyone safely from Spahn to Barker Ranch when Helter Skelter happened, and that they could travel back and forth making sure that Barker was ready and that they were able to find this bottomless pit, he had to have vehicles that could function in the desert. So he basically tricked out these cars into dune buggies that could function in the desert. They had this entire elevated, really well-planned and thought-out chop shop, basically, behind Spahn Ranch, where some people would go and steal the cars and then bring them to Spahn Ranch, where they would be put in the back, and then Charlie and Tex, who were very good with cars, and a bunch of the other guys would just tear them apart and put in water-cooled engines so that the dune buggies wouldn't overheat in the extreme temperatures of the desert. It was really brilliant, actually. He had the right idea. If you were going to survive in Death Valley, you needed dune buggies. So they had an army of dune buggies that were mostly from stolen vehicles. But at first you have to understand the way that he was posing this whole Helter Skelter thing to his followers was that they were just trying to survive the coming violence. They didn't want to be a part of it. They just needed to hide out and wait it out. So it's not really surprising that so many people still kind of went along with this idea. There wasn't any talk about murdering anybody just yet. There wasn't talk about, you know, setting up the Black Panthers just yet. He just said, we've got to get through this so that we can hide out in the Enchanted City and then come back as elevated and evolved beings to run the world. That part I am surprised that they kind of went along with. They were on so many drugs though, so many psychedelic drugs. The women who were told by Charlie that when they got to the Enchanted City in the Bottomless Pit, they could evolve to whatever they wanted, they really wanted to be fairies. And as time passed with Charlie telling the story about the city and where they would go and what they would become, the girls started to say that they could feel little nubs on their back growing where the wings would protrude when they finally evolved to their final fairy form. So it kind of gives you an indication of what the mental state of these people were at the time, almost childlike. The kind of imagination that only a very young child can have. When I was maybe 7, 8, I used to go outside and ride my bike. And I would actually believe, once I imagined it enough, that the bike was a pony. And I named it Starburst because that was the name of the bike. And I took chalk and I made a chalk village with like a general store and a post office and little chalk streets. And I would drive my bike slash horse along these streets. And I believed that I was riding a pony. The way that their minds were functioning was at the level of a very young child. The imaginative young child that I believe eventually we grow out of, which is very sad because it was really fun to imagine something so ferociously that you actually started believing it. But when you become an adult and it's a crazy person who's telling you these stories and who's giving you these visions and these imaginings, it's dangerous. These girls especially were becoming so naive, so childlike, not thinking for themselves, just living in this dream world that he'd created for them. Now, Tex Watson, in November of 1968, he had left the family for a little bit and he moved in with a girlfriend whose name was Luella, and he actually lived the opposite of a hippie life. He and Luella were selling drugs and they were making quite a bit of money. So, you know, he had a fancy haircut, he wore fancy clothes, they would go out to fancy restaurants for dinner, they lived in a nice apartment with all these amenities, and he was kind of living this more sleek LA playboy style life instead of the hippie life that he'd been living on Spahn Ranch. But eventually, when the relationship between Tex and Luella began to fail and go downhill, he went back to Manson in March of 1968 and asked to be welcomed back into the family. He missed the community, he missed the more simple and basic life that he'd had with Manson and the girls. And Manson forgave him for leaving and welcomed him back, but mostly it was because he needed his automotive skills and his manpower because he really needed to get those dune buggies ready for doomsday. And in mid-March, the news that Manson had been waiting for finally arrived. Terry Melcher would be visiting Spahn Ranch to listen to Manson play, finally. Orders were given to the family to get the ranch in tip-top shape for Melcher's arrival. Everything else had to be put on hold to make sure they were ready for him, which confused people. Wasn't Helter Skelter kind of the more immediate concern? Wasn't Doomsday coming? Weren't we trying to find this bottomless pit and learn to walk on the sand without leaving footprints? And didn't there need to be dune buggies made? What's the most important thing on your priority list right now, Charlie? Because, you know, the apocalypse is coming. You told us that. But now Terry Melcher's coming to hear you play and we have to put everything on hold to get ready for that? But why does it matter if you're gonna get signed to a record contract when you've told us that the world as we know it is gonna end anyways? But as I've said, they didn't really think things through. They didn't use logic. There was often times when he would contradict himself. And if even a spark appeared in these people's minds where they were like, that doesn't make sense. You know, it was quickly extinguished by the amount of drugs they were on or by his charisma. They really were already taught to not question him. So even if they thought it, they didn't ever really vocalize it. So they prepared for Terry Melcher's arrival and they tried to clean the ranch, even though it was in the desert and there was sand blowing all over. So it was pretty much a futile task. And Charlie even prepared himself. He bathed and he trimmed his hair. And he had a new suit made for him out of deerskin, which was an extravagant expense that they couldn't really afford at that time. Now, Charlie did not believe in killing animals, so he had the deerskin ordered. I guess little details like the fact that somebody had to kill the deer in order for the skin to be available for Charlie to order were lost on him. He was a big picture kind of guy. At this same time, Sharon Tate and Roman Polanski were making preparations of their own and getting ready for a housewarming party they were going to be throwing on March 15th. The guest list included all the big names in the industry at that time. Tony Curtis, all of the mamas and the papas, Jane and Peter Fonda, Warren Beatty, Also invited to this party were Sharon's core group of friends and acquaintances that she spent most of her time with, including her old beau and longtime friend, Jay Sebring. Thomas John Coomer was born to a middle-class family in Birmingham, Alabama, and after serving in the Navy, he moved to LA, where he changed his name to Jay Sebring. Jay for the first initial of his middle name, and Sebring after the Sebring International Raceway in Florida. Once in California, he attended beauty school, and he invented a new way of cutting men's hair, which included shampooing the hair before cutting it, and using scissors instead of clippers. Jay Sebring honestly has a very interesting story. I wish we could go into more detail, but like I said, this would go on forever. Jay Sebring had a very illustrious and colorful and fun life. But anyways, he invented this new way of cutting hair, and it became very, very popular. And he charged for the privilege of having your hair cut the Jay Sebring way in a time where most men went to the barbershop and paid $1 or $2 for a haircut. Jay Sebring was charging over $50 to have hair cut his way. He was the stylist to the stars like Steve McQueen, Warren Beatty, Kirk Douglas. He even would fly out to Las Vegas every 2 weeks to cut the hair of Sammy Davis Jr. and Frank Sinatra. He wasn't very tall. He was only about 5'6", but Jay Sebring had this really handsome, boyish quality about him. Dark hair, dark eyes, beautiful smile. He was charming and he was very good with the ladies. He really liked cars, so he had a Mustang Cobra and sometimes he drove around a black Porsche, and he was well known in the Hollywood circles, but he was also a devoted friend to Sharon Tate. He really, really cared about her. Wojtek Frykowski was a friend of Roman's from Poland who had already been married twice when he met Abigail Folger in New York City. Abigail was the heiress to the Folger coffee fortune, and even though Wojtek did not speak English, Abigail, who was born into wealth and high society, was fluent in French, which he spoke as well. The two lived in New York City for a while, but in August of 1968, they headed west, where they rented a house on Woodstock Road, right across the street from Mama Cass of the Mamas and the Papas. Wojtek didn't seem to want to work for a living. He kept a diary where he would make notes about American customs, so it seemed like he might want to be a writer, but I don't think he ever really followed through with that. He also worked as a set constructor at Paramount Studios for a little bit, but he quit because he didn't like that. Basically, it seemed like he was just living off of Abigail's money, and there are rumors and stories that say he was embezzling some of it as well. But he seemed to like being in LA. He was close to his old friend Roman. They'd known each other for years, and he would often bring his girlfriend, Abigail Folger, to the Polanski residence where she became close with Roman and Sharon as well. The two would actually house sit for the couple when they were away in April of 1969. And when they got back, Wojtek asked Roman and Sharon if it would be okay if he and Abigail just kind of stayed at the Cielo Drive house for a little bit. And Sharon, who was often alone because Roman was out of town a lot and who was very kind-hearted, agreed to it. Now, Abigail Folger, in my opinion, was a shining star in the world. Yes, she came from money. Yes, she, you know, was an heiress and she had education. She graduated from Harvard. She had everything that she could ever want or need, but she had learned from her mother to give back to the less fortunate. Abigail's mother was very into volunteering and community service work. The two of them worked together in the summer of 68 at the free clinic in the Haight, helping people who didn't have money or health insurance. And Abigail spent most of her time volunteering as a social worker for the LA County Welfare Department. She was also an investor in Jay Sebring's company, Sebring International. She worked a lot in the poorer areas of LA, like the Watts area where the big riot had happened. And she began to get so discouraged by seeing, especially the kids, and how they didn't have what they needed, and how, you know, society had kind of turned their backs on them. It really got her down. She really felt it strongly and heavily. And she knew that just being the one person that she was, she couldn't help everybody. In order to cheer herself up, she got herself a Dalmatian puppy named Tom. These murders were called the Tate murders, so it's not uncommon for Sharon Tate to be the one highlighted when people think about the Manson family and who they killed. It's always a Sharon Tate, which obviously is sad. She was an amazing person in her own right, and she didn't deserve what happened to her. But there were other victims, and Jay Sebring was an incredibly talented young man who was going places, and Abigail Folger was a very kind-hearted, giving, and caring person whose life was cut short for absolute no reason, for just being in the wrong place at the wrong time. So it's always very important to remember the other people that this happened to. It wasn't just Sharon Tate there that night. The day after the housewarming party, Roman left to go to London. He was working on a movie there. And on March 24th, Sharon would be leaving to go to Rome. She was still working, and this was kind of going to be the last thing that she did before she had the baby. The day before she left, Abigail Folger, Wojtek Frykowski, Jay Sebring, and a photographer friend of Sharon's all gathered at the home to have a going away dinner for her. Now, the name of Sharon Tate's photographer friend, who's also one of her personal photographers, his name was Sharok Hatimi. I hope I said that right, but I probably didn't, so don't come for me. But as they all sat in the dining room having dinner, the group noticed that there was a strange man walking around on the property. So Hatimi went outside and asked the guy, like, "What do you want? What are you doing here?" This man was Charles Manson, an angry Charles Manson, who had shown up to the Cielo Drive home looking for Terry Melcher, who had not shown up to Spawn Ranch when he was supposed to hear him sing. Manson had sent his family into a tizzy, dropping everything to prepare for the arrival of a man that never showed up and never called or let anybody know why. And it was embarrassing to Manson to be stood up that way. Terry Melcher had embarrassed Manson in front of his following, and he was there now to tell him off and make him come back with him to Spawn Ranch so that the family could see Manson still had control over the situation. When Manson told Hatimi that he was looking for Terry Melcher, the photographer told him, "No one by that name lives here. This is the Polanski residence, but maybe the person you're looking for is in the guest house." As Manson turned to go, Sharon Tate walked outside and asked Hatimi who it was. And at this point, it's believed that Sharon and Manson, you know, did make eye contact and saw each other for the first and last time. Now, Rudy Altobelli was in the shower when Manson walked up onto the porch of the guest cottage at Cielo Drive. And when he got out, he saw him standing outside, and he opened the door and he said, "What do you want?" Manson tried to explain to him who he was and why he was there, and Rudy interrupted him and was like, "Yeah, Charlie, I know who you are. What do you want?" Manson explained to Rudy that he was there looking for Melcher and they had some business to settle. And Rudy told Manson he doesn't live here anymore. And when Manson asked him, "Well, where does he live now?" Rudy lied and said he didn't know. But he would really like it if Manson would avoid coming onto the property and annoying his tenants or bothering his tenants from now on. The next day, Sharon Tate and Rudy Altobelli, they flew together to Rome, and Manson got everybody back on track, looking towards Helter Skelter and getting those dune buggies ready. Not only did they need more dune buggies, but the women really needed to try to get pregnant more often. They were going to need 144,000 people, as told by the Book of Revelations. That was the number that they would need before they were able to emerge and take over the world. So they really needed to get started. I'm not quite sure how Charlie thought that, I don't know, a dozen or maybe 15 women were going to get pregnant and give birth to 144,000 people, but maybe in the Enchanted City under the desert, you only have to be pregnant for 12 days like a possum, so you can really like knock them out instead of having to wait, you know, almost a year to actually give birth. But I'm not sure, that was their part and that's what he wanted them to do. And let's get back to Tex Watson for a moment, because Tex's story, it just continues to get weirder. According to testimony from Paul Watkins, Paul and Manson were driving through the desert one day when a man came out and kicked them off his property. Manson got mad and wanted to poison the man. So he asked Paul, did Paul know about any poisons that were close by that they could use? And Paul, who had spent some time on an Indian reservation when he was younger, in fact did know where they could find some poison. He had seen some belladonna growing in the hills around Spawn Ranch, and he knew very well what belladonna could do to a person. So Paul Watkins dug up some belladonna and he gave it to another member named Brenda to boil into a tea, which allegedly they would then give to the man who kicked Charlie and Paul off his property. Why this man would accept tea from them and drink it, I'm not sure, but that was the plan. But as they were doing this, Tex Watson walked into the kitchen. He was on his way out to go pick up his motorcycle from impound, and he thought that the belladonna root looked like sweet potatoes. So he grabbed a big chunk and started eating it, and he told them, like, "Oh, hey, I'm gonna go get my bike. I'll be back later," and left. Now, Paul Watkins remembered the last time he saw Tex was when Tex was walking out of the kitchen chewing on this belladonna root. I'm not sure why Paul or Brenda didn't say, "Hey, that's not sweet potatoes. You probably shouldn't eat that. It's either gonna kill you or make you go crazy," but they didn't, and Tex left to go get his bike. Nobody saw him again for 3 days. Belladonna, or nightshade, is a very powerful hallucinogenic. And the next thing Tex knew, he was being arrested in Van Nuys for public intoxication. He was crawling on his hands and knees through a group of children saying, beep, beep. Tex was taken in. He was fingerprinted, but he wasn't really even able to sign his own name. He was so out of it and crazy. This was the worst trip that somebody could have been on. He was making crazy faces and grimaces in his mugshot when he got arrested. And then he was put in a cell with a bunch of other prisoners who had no time or patience for a cellmate who was gonna act like a complete lunatic for the whole time. So they beat the crap out of him and he had to be hospitalized. He was released the next day, but his fingerprints were still on file. And Tex's friends and family members claim that after this Belladonna incident, he was never the same. His personality had changed permanently. He was harder, meaner, more bullying, more aggressive, violent. And now he considered himself Charlie's right-hand man, which Charlie didn't mind because he liked this new restless, violent, aggressive Tex Watson. Charlie and his family really needed money. They were desperate. So they had a couple plans and none of them really turned out well. The first one that we're going to talk about is when Charlie opened up a bar in the saloon on Spawn Ranch. He painted it black, he painted some psychedelic symbols on the wall and played Beatles music, put some beer on ice and called the bar Helter Skelter. It was actually pretty popular for a couple of days with the ranch hands and the local kids, but after only a couple of days, the authorities caught on, they shut it down and they slapped George Spawn with a $1,500 fine for illegally operating a bar. So Manson started an alliance with a group of bikers called the Straight Satans. He was hoping that he could partner with them and make a profit selling drugs. They would work together to sling drugs and split the profits, and Charlie would throw in his women as an added bonus. The bikers had their pick of any girls that they wanted, but Charlie also threw in Ruth Ann Morehouse and Leslie Van Houten to sweeten the deal. They were considered the prettiest girls and the ones he usually reserved for special occasions to draw in the big fish for the special guests of the family. But with the introduction of the Straight Satans into the family's dynamic, a lot of the members now had access to harder drugs like speed or meth. Tex Watson and Susan Atkins were the biggest abusers. They had a secret stash of speed that they kept hidden away from Manson, who didn't like the harder stuff. They didn't want him to know they were taking it, but they would sneak away together and take it for certain times and days when they needed more of an edge. The Creepy Crawlies also started at this time. Now, the Creepy Crawlies initially started off as a game, I think. Manson and a couple of people would go into houses in the richer part of town, and they wouldn't take anything. They wouldn't hurt anybody, but they would just kind of move their furniture around. They just wanted to mess with people. They would sneak in and out without a sound, and when the occupants of the houses awoke, they would find that their house had been broken into, but nothing had been taken, and it would kind of unsettle them a little bit. And that's what Charlie wanted. He wanted them to know, you're not untouchable. We can still get to you. It made the family feel powerful and above the law. Now, 2 months after Terry Melcher was originally supposed to come to Spawn Ranch and hear Charlie play music and sing, he did finally show up on May 18th. And once again, the family was sent running in circles to prepare for his arrival. The girls baked cookies and muffins, and Charlie put on his deerskin suit. Charlie made the girls rehearse with him tirelessly in the weeks leading up to this. All night and all day, just singing back up for him, and he taught them how they should strip their clothes off suggestively to the music. But when Melcher arrived, he wasn't interested in baked goods or talking to Charlie about his philosophies or even messing around with any of the girls. He was all business at this point. He came for one thing, and he was going to listen to Manson, and then he was gonna go. After the performance, Melcher wasn't really interested in anything that Charlie had to offer, but he did give Charlie $50. Melcher felt bad for the people in the ranch. He knew that a big part of what they did was go through dumpsters and things to get food, and he noticed that there was a lot of children running around. So he thought if the $50 could help these people in some way, then it was something he was willing to give. But he was not willing to give Manson a recording contract. He didn't think that Manson had anything that anybody else who was trying to get famous at that point in time didn't have. When he was gone, the family gathered around Charlie to see what had happened. Was he gonna sign you? When do you start? And even though Manson knew it was pretty much over. It wasn't going to happen. He couldn't have anybody thinking that or knowing that. He had to keep their faith in him. And Charlie Manson wasn't somebody who got rejected. So he showed them the $50 and he was like, listen, he wanted me to sign a contract right now, but I don't do contracts. That's like a societal thing. So he gave me this $50 and I gave him my word. And everybody knows I'm a man of my word. So they were all impressed. They're like, whoa, he's going to make it. This is going to happen for us. Charlie's plan was that if now anything went wrong, or when they all discovered that he wasn't actually going to get signed, he would make it look as if Melcher had welched on the deal, as if he'd backed out, as if he was the bad guy. And that's exactly what happened. Terry wasn't interested in signing Charlie, but he knew of a smaller producer who would drive around in a van and kind of record people on reservations and communes. And he thought maybe that guy would want to hear what Charlie had. Maybe those two could hook up and, you know, he'd be out of Melcher's hair. So he brought this guy to the ranch on June 6th, 1969. But while the producer was there, someone slipped him a good amount of LSD and he tripped so badly, he had to be taken home immediately. So while Terry and this guy and Manson were walking out to Terry's car so Terry could get the guy home, Manson's still following behind, talking about himself, talking about all the things they can do together. When Randy Starr ran up and started waving a gun at them. Now, Randy Starr is another funny little piece of this Charlie Manson puzzle. Randy was a Hollywood stuntman who was working as a ranch hand at Spawn when Manson and the family settled there. When he ran up to Manson and Terry, he was drunk and he was just kind of messing around with the gun, but Manson freaked out and he said, "Don't you draw on me!" And then he beat the crap out of this guy, like within an inch of his life. And Randy Starr was like twice his size. But Manson took him down. And Terry, seeing all this happen, he was kind of like, I don't know whether to be grateful that Manson maybe saved my life or to be disgusted that he just beat this guy within an inch of his life while I'm standing here. Terry drove away from Spawn Ranch that day knowing that it was the last time he was going to be there. Whether he was scared or grateful or admired Charlie or thought maybe he had something special, he just didn't want to deal with it anymore. Manson knew that too, so he told the family that Terry had betrayed him and turned his back on him. And he wanted to keep Manson's music from the public. That was the whole goal. That was what Helter Skelter was all about. It was happening. When people wanted to keep something that was good for the world away from the world, it showed you that the world was coming to an end. But now Charlie was off the rails, and most of his family was right there with him. The creepy crawlies at night turned into robberies, with mostly credit cards and money being taken. And when Manson finally figured out where Terry Melcher lived in Malibu, they went to Melcher's house and they stole a telescope off his porch. In their eyes, they were sending him a message. No matter where you go, we'll find you. We can see you. Terry Melcher, once he had left Spawn Ranch, he didn't give Manson and his crew another thought. He was on to bigger and better things. They weren't even on his radar. So he just saw the telescope was gone and was like, oh, somebody stole my telescope. He didn't make the connection between Manson and the missing telescope at all. So while the family's all like, haha, we really stuck it to Terry. He's going to be so scared when he sees that telescope is missing. Terry Melcher didn't really feel anything about it at all. He definitely didn't take it as a message from Charles Manson. But that's how ingrained in their own little world they were. They thought that they were so important, so essential to everybody's lives that they entered. It's a very delusional, paranoid way of thinking. It's like when you look at Facebook and somebody writes something like, oh, if I cut you off, it's because you handed me the scissors. One of those stupid generic pictures where they post it, but they don't give any explanation because then they want you to be like, oh my God, what happened? Who did this to you? Well, when you look at that picture and you think like, oh my God, they're talking about me. That's how Manson's family was. They're the person that literally would look on Facebook or Twitter and find all of these obscure comments from people that they know and think that they're talking about them. In his daily and nightly sermons, he now started wondering aloud, maybe they should amp the creepy crawlies up a little bit. Maybe they should start kidnapping people or tying them up and scaring them. He asked his family, would you die for me? And some of them agreed without a doubt. Some of them were not so on board with that idea. Pat Krenwinkel, she tried to escape. She left with a member of the Straight Satans. But within a couple of days, Charlie tracked her down and he made her come back with him. She thought it was because he was magical. So this reinforced in her head that he was an otherworldly being, and no matter where she went, he would find her. So why bother leaving? Really, it was just that Manson had a lot of contacts in the city and a lot of connections, and he was able to find out who had seen this guy and Pat together and then track them down. When Leslie Van Houten expressed her concerns about things kind of getting violent and weird, Charlie drove her to the top of a hill, and they got out, and he told her, hey, if you really want to leave me, you can go ahead and jump. And so at this point, they were kind of going back and forth between Spahn and Barker Ranch, just trying to get everything prepared, hiding food on the way. When they were at Barker Ranch, they were kind of going out. Every once in a while, he was sending people out to look for this bottomless pit in the desert. And previously, they had all gone out to Barker Ranch and then left, but they'd left two people behind to kind of keep an eye on things and make sure that no one else came in and tried to settle in that area. But the two people that they'd left behind, Brooks Poston and a girl named Juanita, they had pretty much defected at this point. Brooks and Juanita had been at Barker Ranch since February, and when the rest of the family left them there, they said they'd be back within 10 days, but they never did come back. They were there alone when a man named Paul Crockett and his partner stopped by. This was around March 11th, and Crockett could tell that Juanita and Brooks were under some kind of mind control. They were unable to invite him in, but they were also unable to send him away. They didn't know what to do, since they hadn't been given specific orders on what to do in this specific situation, so they pretty much just didn't do anything. Paul and his partner were gold prospectors, but Paul had also studied with one of the five founding members of the Church of Scientology in his early days, so he knew a little something about what it looked like when someone was in a cult, when they were under somebody else's control. He also knew how to deprogram them from that control. Paul taught Brooks and Juanita that the way that Charlie had control over them was through agreements. The agreement that Charlie was something special, that Charlie was powerful. The agreement that served Charlie's purposes, but nobody else's. Paul Crockett said that these implied agreements were very powerful, and that was what was making it difficult to break away from Charlie. Over the course of 8 months during the spring and summer of 1969, he worked with them. They would go over to where he had settled and hang out with him, and he told them that their egos had been stripped from them completely. This was why they were unable at this point to think independently. When they would visit him, he began the task of deprogramming them, and he used basically physical labor and stuff at first so that they would be distracted. And then he started kind of ordering them to do things. So he would say, follow me, because that was what they were familiar with. After they began to trust him and follow him, he then started to ask them questions. Ask them to make plans for the future. So, what do you want to do tomorrow? What are your plans for next week? This way they could think past the commands and begin using goal-setting methods. Juanita and Brooks said they were worried to even be visiting him because they knew that Charlie had magical powers, but Crockett told them that he had magical powers too. When he was 15, he'd been thrown from a car, and he had managed to basically create a force field around himself so that when he landed, he would be unharmed. When he was in the war and flying a B-24, he'd been under enemy attack and some shrapnel had come through the plane, but he had managed to slow down time so that he could avoid being hit by the shrapnel. He told them that he'd created a magical boundary around his area and that Manson could not enter it without being granted permission to do so. Later, when the rest of the family finally did arrive at Barker Ranch, Manson figured out what happened, and he sent a couple of people over to Crockett's to try to get Poston and Juanita to come back. Paul Watkins, one of his most devout followers since the beginning, and Barbara, the one who had made the Belladonna tea, they went over there and basically told Juanita and Poston, like, Manson wants you to come back. Now, Barbara had always been a member of the family who had pushed back against Manson. And Juanita remembered one day that Barbara had been stoned for questioning him. And as this was happening, the rest of the family sat around chanting and watching it happen. Barbara looked at them and said, you're all evil and this is hell. And Charlie told her, of course this is hell. Remember, everything your mommy told you was wrong. Where you want to be is hell, and we're all devils. Manson spent a lot of time working on Barbara specifically, trying to break her. And Juanita remembers that when Paul and Barbara came to try to get them to come back, Barbara seemed very interested in how they'd been able to break Manson's spell. Even after Brooks Poston and Juanita said they weren't gonna go back, Paul Watkins and Barbara stayed for days, allegedly trying to convince them to come back, but it seemed like they were just trying to figure out how they'd managed to get away. Eventually, Paul said they needed to get back to Manson, but they weren't looking forward to letting Manson know that Poston and Juanita had refused to come back. Before they left, Juanita and Brooks Poston asked Paul to do something very specific when telling Manson about their desertion. In front of the whole family, Paul should ask Manson to release Poston and Juanita from their agreements, and they would in turn release Manson from any agreements they'd made with him. Since Charlie always made a big deal about nobody being in charge, nobody being better than anybody else, he'd be unable to refuse this request when faced with his entire following sitting there and looking at him. Charlie responded, "Of course they're released. No one has any agreements with me, with us." Watkins then asked him, "Well then, do you release me from my agreements?" And Manson replied, "Of course." And then Barbara piped up, "And me?" And Manson said, "Yeah." And then Paul Watkins motioned to the rest of the people sitting around and said, "What about them?" And then Charlie got agitated and he was like, "Enough with this shit about agreements." And he wouldn't release anybody else. Paul Watkins returned to Crockett, Juanita, and Poston in June. He'd finally broken the spell that Manson had put on him. Paul Watkins would still visit the ranch. He had a relationship with one of the girls there, and he would go there and, you know, smoke weed and play music with them. But whenever Manson started talking about Helter Skelter and asked him to participate in any of those activities, Paul answered with a firm no. And the whole Helter Skelter preparations had been amped up at this time. Everybody was getting amped up. They kept asking Manson, "When's this gonna happen? When's this gonna happen?" Now, I believe that Manson never really thought that Helter Skelter was gonna happen. He didn't believe in it. And by his own words, it was something he didn't believe in. It was just kind of a distraction for people. When people kept asking him and they were getting kind of restless, he had to do and say something to calm them and give them what they wanted. So he started to wonder out loud, maybe the blacks were too stupid to get Helter Skelter started on their own. Maybe they'd need some help. Now, they had been raided back in April because the police had discovered they'd been stealing cars and then turning them into dune buggies, and a lot of these dune buggies had been taken. Without the proper vehicles, hiding out in the desert wasn't going to last very long, so he and Tex came up with a plan. Another stupid plan and a series of stupid plans that Manson and Tex Watson would formulate together. The girl that Tex had been dating before, Luella, she was still dealing drugs. And on July 1st, Tex called her and he told her he had a bunch of drugs that he needed to get rid of and sell. And did she have a buyer for them? She told him she did know someone who would give them some money up front and then the rest of the money upon delivery of the 25 kilos of marijuana. Tex met with the buyer, a big, scary drug dealer from LA named Bernard Crow, but everybody called him Lotsa Papa. Lotsa Papa gave him the $2,500 up front, but he wasn't stupid. He wasn't born yesterday. This was his gig. He knew all about the drug dealing world, and he wasn't gonna let Tex walk away with the money just giving a promise that he would deliver the drugs. So Lotsa Papa said that he was gonna hold on to Luella until Tex got back. But there were no drugs. They didn't have any drugs. So Tex brought the money back to Charlie. He claims by his own admission, he didn't care what happened to Luella. He just knew Charlie needed the money. That was his goal, that was his mission, and he'd achieved it. When he got back, he told Manson what had happened and that Lotsa Papa may be calling and looking for him. So Charlie should say that Tex had deserted Spawn Ranch weeks before. Within no time, Lotsa Papa was calling the ranch and asking where Tex was. And Charlie stayed to the plan and said he hadn't been there in weeks, but Lotsa Papa did not believe him. So he told Charlie, "Hey, you either give me my money or my drugs back, or me and my guys are gonna be at your ranch in a matter of days and we're gonna just destroy it and kill everybody there." Manson thought it would be a good idea if he cut Lotsa Papa off at the pass. So he grabbed another member, Thomas Wallerman, otherwise known as TJ, gave him a gun and said, "Listen, we're gonna go find this drug dealer and then you're gonna kill him. I'm not gonna pull the trigger, you're gonna pull the trigger. You're gonna kill this dude, okay? Let's go." When the time came and they were faced with Lotsa Papa and it was time to pull the trigger, TJ couldn't do it though. So Manson thought, if you need something done, do it yourself. And he grabbed the gun from TJ and shot Lotsa Papa in the chest. Before they left, Manson grabbed a leather jacket from the scene of the crime and took to wearing it quite often. The next day, a story that a Black Panther had been found dead was on the news, and Charlie panicked. Bernard Crow was black, and he had killed him yesterday. So that meant he'd killed a Black Panther. However, Bernard Crow wasn't in the Black Panthers, and he wasn't dead either. Manson thought he had killed him, but he hadn't. Once again, it shows you the way that Manson's mind worked, how his reality was the only one that existed. I shot a black guy yesterday. Today, a black guy on the news is found dead. Must be the same black guy. There's no other black guys in LA. That's the one I killed. Charlie had no idea that Latsapapa survived the attack until he testified against him at trial later. Afterwards, Manson was furious with TJ for not having the guts to actually do what needed to be done, and TJ ran away. He'd seen that Manson was willing to kill and capable of doing so, and he didn't want the next bout of rage to be turned on him. Manson told everybody at the ranch that he'd killed a Black Panther, and they needed to be on high alert now because it was more than likely at this point that his comrades would be at the ranch very soon to avenge their fallen brother's death. In July, another member joined the family. Linda Kasabian was from a working-class family from New England. Her parents struggled with money and relationship issues, and eventually her father left, abandoning his wife and daughter. Her mother remarried, but her new husband and her daughter did not get along. She was described as starry-eyed and romantic. Shy, intelligent, but forced to grow up too quickly. When she was 16, she left home and went west in search of God. She got married and divorced, drifted to Florida where her father had moved to try to reconnect with him unsuccessfully, and then moved to Boston where she met and married Robert Kasabian. The two had a daughter they named Tanya, but the relationship went south very quickly and Linda and her baby went back to New Hampshire to live with her mother. Later, Robert contacted Linda and told her he wanted to reunite, and would she come to LA where he and his friend were planning a sailing trip to South America. They lived together in the Topanga Canyon area for a while, and Linda became pregnant again, but then her husband left her to go on the sailing trip, and she was feeling aimless and betrayed when she met Gypsy. Gypsy told her about this utopia that she lived in, where everybody was happy and loved each other. They were all searching together for an underground city where they would wait out the violence and turmoil that was coming. On July 4th, Linda and her baby daughter joined Gypsy and went back to Spawn Ranch. Upon her arrival, Tanya was taken from her and put with the other children to be raised by somebody else. And that same night, she met and had sexual relations with Tex Watson. Shortly thereafter, she was introduced to Charlie, who she was very impressed with. She thought he looked godlike in his deerskin outfit. And after she had sex with him, he talked to her about why he thought that she had come to be with them. He'd always been very good at sniffing out people's weaknesses, their Achilles heel. He basically told her, "You're here because you have daddy issues." And she was like, "What? I do have daddy issues. I hate my stepfather, and my father abandoned me, and when I tried to reconnect with him, that didn't work. I do have daddy issues. This guy's brilliant." The most valuable thing about Linda to Charlie, however, was the fact that she had a valid driver's license, the only person at this time who had a valid driver's license. In July, Manson went looking for Dennis Wilson. He was out of money again. The $2,500 they'd gotten from the botched drug deal with Latsapapa had run out very quickly, and Dennis Wilson had always been so generous in the past. He was an easy target. And didn't he owe Charlie for that song that he'd stolen from him? Now, allegedly, when Charlie and Dennis finally did meet up, Charlie took a bullet out and showed it to Dennis Wilson. And when Dennis said, "What's that?" Charlie said, "It's a bullet. And every time you look at it, I want you to think about how nice it is that your children are still safe." According to reports, Dennis Wilson didn't take that very well. He took it as a threat. Surprise, surprise. And he proceeded to grab Manson by the head, throw him down on the ground, and give him a thorough beating in front of everybody who was there. Needless to say, Dennis Wilson was no longer going to be a source of income for Manson, so he needed to find another way to get money, and fast. Enter Gary Hinman, the music teacher slash mescaline grower from Topanga Canyon. The guy they had actually spent a lot of time with, who had been gracious and generous enough to let them stay in his house and let them drive his cars. Charlie thought, because of where he lived and the job he had, that he was pretty wealthy and had a lot of money. There was also another reason that he was interested in meeting back up with Gary Hinman. Bobby Beausoleil had bought a lot of mescaline off of Gary Hinman, and he had sold it to the Straight Satans. But according to the Straight Satans, they had had a pretty bad experience with it, and they thought that the mescaline had been a bad batch. So they told Bobby that they needed their money back. Bobby went to Hinman's home with Mary Bruner and Susan Atkins, and he told Gary, "You sold me some bad drugs and I need the money back." And Gary Hinman was like, "There must be some mistake. Those drugs weren't bad, and even if they were, I already spent that $1,000 that you gave me." Bobby didn't believe him, so Gary actually had to pull out his checkbook and show him how the money had gone in and how it had gone out. Bobby had Susan Atkins hold Gary at gunpoint while he rummaged around his house trying to find something that would be worth the $1,000. As he was looking around the house, Gary Hinman lunged at Susan to try to get the gun from her. And as they were struggling for the gun, Susan called for Bobby's help. So Bobby ran in. It's the three of them wrestling for this gun, trying to get possession of it. And as they were doing that, the gun went off. It didn't hit anybody, but it kind of stunned everyone. And it allowed Bobby to get the gun back in his possession. Gary Hinman begged for them to leave and not hurt him. He even signed over both his cars to them so that they would go. But when Bobby called Manson at the ranch and let him know that he didn't have any money for him, Manson was like, I'm gonna handle this. And he grabbed his samurai sword and Bruce Davis and they drove over to Hinman's house. As soon as they got there, Manson proceeded to take the samurai sword and basically almost entirely slash off Gary Hinman's left ear. And then he and Bruce Davis left. Bruce took the car that they'd come in and Manson took one of Gary Hinman's cars. Now at this point, Gary Hinman's freaking out, right? He's just had his ear slashed off with a samurai sword. And the girls kind of had a soft spot for him. I'm pretty sure both of them had slept with him at one time or multiple times. And he was begging to get medical attention. Will you bring me to the hospital? Please, like my ear is going to fall off. So Susan and Mary ended up taking some dental floss and stitching his ear back on, or trying to. I'm sure it was not a very accurate job. Gary Hinman's pretty pissed off now. He's given them his cars. He doesn't really have any money to give them. And now his ears sewed on with dental floss. So he tells them he's gonna go to the police. And as soon as he says that, Bobby allegedly called Manson at the ranch and allegedly Manson told him, you know what to do. If Hinman had to die anyways, because he was gonna turn them in if they let him live, they might as well use this opportunity to kickstart Helter Skelter. Bobby stabbed Hinman in the chest twice, and he and the two girls took turns holding a pillow over Gary's face until he was dead. After that, Bobby Beausoleil took Hinman's blood and made this sort of crude paw print on the wall to represent the Black Panthers. And then next to the paw print on the wall, he wrote political piggy in Hinman's blood. The three of them walked around the house trying to wipe away fingerprints or, you know, remove any trace of evidence that they'd been there. And afterwards, they got into Hinman's other car and they drove back to Spahn Ranch. When everybody was back at the ranch, they waited for the news to break. But after a couple of days, they hadn't heard anything. Bobby returned to the scene, concerned that the paw print that he'd made in blood with his own hand would somehow lead the police to him. So he tried to scrub it off, but it was already dried on and it wouldn't budge. And although Charlie wanted the murder of Hinman kept quiet, Susan and Bobby couldn't help but brag about it. That was in Susan's personality. She wanted everybody to know that she was kind of in charge and she had what it took to do what was needed to be done. And Bobby, he didn't like the fact that after Manson had killed Lots of Papa, he bragged about it to everybody, but now he wanted Bobby to be quiet about his contribution to the cause. Susan gossiped with the other girls about the noises that Gary Hinman had made as he was dying, and this disgusted quite a few of them. Ella Jo Bailey and a male member of the family that she had been dating decided to leave, and they asked Pat Krenwinkle to come with them because Pat and Ella were friends. But Pat remembered how the last time she'd left, Manson had found her very quickly, and she knew, or she thought she knew, that no matter where they went, they would be found, so she didn't feel like there was any point in trying to escape. The police discovered Hinman's body on July 31st when a couple of his friends stopped by at his house to visit and they were concerned when he didn't answer the door. Police went through the scene and collected evidence, including a very nice and whole thumbprint in blood, and they also made note that both of Hinman's cars were gone. Now, Charlie had his Volkswagen and he'd already gotten rid of that, but Bobby was still driving around in his Fiat, and he had stashed the bloody murder weapon in the wheel well of the car. Now, Charlie at this point was getting kind of anxious. You've got what he thought was the murder of Lots of Papa and the murder of Gary Hinman. And he kind of feels like any day now, the authorities are gonna descend on Spahn Ranch or Barker Ranch and take all of them to prison. So he wanted to leave for a couple of days to clear his head. On August 3rd, he drove north. And this was when he picked up what would become his last girlfriend, a 17-year-old named Stephanie Schramm. She was on a trip back from Reno with a friend of hers, and they'd stopped at a gas station so she could use the bathroom. Charlie had spent the night smoking weed in his car by the ocean, and around 2 a.m., he ventured into that same gas station when he saw a pretty girl going into the bathroom. He waited for her to come out, and when she did come out, he approached her with the best pickup line ever. What's a pretty girl like you doing out so late? It literally only took a couple of minutes, and Stephanie was under his spell. She told her friend she wasn't going to be continuing on. She was going to be going with Charlie. Okay, sorry for the outfit change. This is a different day. I had to pick Aiden up from school sick, so I had to stop recording. So we're going to resume here. When Manson got back to Spawn Ranch with his new girlfriend, Stephanie, she was in for a shock like so many before her who thought that they were Manson's one and only. She discovered that there was many more girls living with her boyfriend that she would now have to compete for. And he appeased her by telling her that, yeah, everything was kind of crazy right now, but in a couple of weeks, he would be exclusively hers. And when Manson got back, he was feeling kind of relaxed and good after a couple of days away. He'd had some fun, he'd seen the ocean, he met a new girl. But everybody at Spawn Ranch was super stressed out, and there was a tension in the air. And the reason for that was because Bobby Beausoleil had been arrested. On August 6th, two highway patrolmen spotted a broken down Fiat on a highway near San Luis Obispo, and they ran the plates and saw that there was an APB out on it in relation to a murder. So they walk up to the car and they see Bobby Beausoleil curled up inside, sleeping. They wake him up and they ask him what's going on with this car, and at first he lied and he said that he had just bought it from a black guy a couple of days ago. He was trying to keep up the whole helter-skelter thing. But they weren't buying that, so they promptly arrested him and they impounded the car, and it wasn't long before they found the bloody knife in the wheel well of the Fiat. On top of that, they had the thumbprint that they'd found at the murder scene at Hinman's house, and it matched Bobby. So he pivoted, he changed his story, and he said that he and a couple of friends had gone to Gary's house and they'd found him already attacked. So they tried to provide him some medical aid, and because of that, he was so grateful that he signed over both of his cars to them. Then they left, and after that, he must have died. Well, even though this was a very believable story, the police did not believe it, and they charged him with the murder of Gary Hinman. Bobby had used his one phone call to call Charlie at the ranch, but Charlie was still on his finding yourself mission. He was off taking drugs, picking up girls in gas station bathrooms. So Bobby talked to Linda Kasabian, and he basically said, listen, I'm not gonna say anything, I'm not gonna talk, but if Charlie could help, that would really be great. 2 days later, Friday, August 8th, a handyman was at the Polanski residence and he was painting the room that would become the nursery for Sharon and Roman's child. And he removed the screens out of the windows in these rooms so that they wouldn't get paint on them. And then he left the windows open and left the house around 1:30 p.m. so that the room could dry. Two trunks had also been delivered to the home that day that belonged to Roman in preparation for his arrival. And he had talked to his wife, Sharon, on the phone earlier that day and promised that he would be home in time for his birthday on August 18th. Sharon Tate had lunch with some friends, and she also received a call from Jay Sebring, who told her he would be by to visit her that evening. Rudy Altobelli, who was still out of town, had arranged for a temporary groundskeeper to be staying in the guest cottage while he was gone, and this man's name was William Gerritsen. Earlier that day, the gardener had told William to make sure that he watered the gardens and the grounds that weekend because it was supposed to be very hot. But at that point, William wasn't feeling very well, so he was just in the guest cottage, basically sleeping it off. When Charlie returned home and heard about Bobby's arrest, he knew he had to do something to at least try and get him out, or it would only be a matter of time before he cracked. He contemplated just leaving, which is usually what he did when the heat started to get on him, but his followers told him they would do anything to keep their Messiah with them, and they started brainstorming what they could do to get Bobby out. Some of the family members recalled a movie they'd seen recently about a murderer that had gotten released from prison because of a string of copycat murders. So maybe they could commit more murders that looked like Hinman's murder. That way the police thought they had the wrong guy behind bars and they would let Bobby go. They honestly had no idea how the law works. None of these people had a clue about how the law works. This would also hopefully serve the dual purpose of getting Helter Skelter kickstarted, because the things they'd left behind at the scene of Hinman's murder, the paw print and the words, they hadn't really been publicized or looked into as anything, so it hadn't achieved the result they wanted. Mary Bruner and Lynette Squeaky Fromm were given some stolen credit cards to go to Sears and purchase some things for the family. Now, Charlie claims that he forgot these credit cards were stolen. That's his story, which it kind of begs the question, did you think that you had credit cards? Did you remember going to the bank and applying for a credit card. But anyways, they went to Sears with the stolen credit cards and they were arrested for trying to use stolen credit cards. With Mary, Squeaky, and Bobby all behind bars, Charlie really started to freak out because at any time now, any one of them could turn on them. So the night of August 8th, 1969, Charlie and Tex Watson began to prepare for the events of that evening. According to Tex Watson, he had already been tripping on LSD that day, so he didn't even know what was going on. And Charlie picked three girls to go with him: Susan Atkins, Patricia Krenwinkle, and Linda Kasabian. Basically brand new to this group, been there for a month, but she had a valid driver's license, and he wanted to make sure that on their way to commit a crime, they didn't get pulled over for the crime of driving without a valid driver's license. According to Manson himself, he told Tex to go to a place like where Terry Melcher lived. He claims he didn't explicitly tell Tex to go to Cielo Drive and kill Sharon Tate. And although this series of events that would follow is often painted as a revenge story, Charlie Manson being mad at Terry Melcher for his rejection, so he sent people to his house to kill him, not knowing he didn't live there anymore. That's not true. We know that Manson knew Melcher didn't live at Cielo Drive anymore. He'd gone there and been told he didn't live there. And then afterwards, they found his new house in Malibu and stole his telescope off his porch. So Manson was very aware that Terry Melcher did not live at this house. Now, Vincent Bugliosi, in his book Helter Skelter, would have you believe that Manson did say explicitly to Tex, go to this house. I don't believe that's true. There's no motive for Tex to go specifically to that house. Charlie wanted him to go to a house like that. He didn't really care what house it was. Tex just happened to choose that house, most likely because he was so high, he didn't know which way was up, and that was the easiest address for him to remember because he'd been there once before with Manson and Dennis Wilson when Dennis had dropped Terry Melcher off home. They made sure to bring their knives, some rope, and wear dark clothes, and they also had a change of clothes that they would wear after the deed was done. Pat Krenwinkle couldn't find her knife, but she didn't want to tell anybody and have them wait for her. And Manson gave Tex a .22 caliber high standard blunt line revolver that he had used to shoot lots of papa. Now, he did explicitly tell Tex, don't use this gun unless you absolutely have to, because obviously the gun's going to make noise. Always use your knives if at all possible. This gun was the same one that stuntman Randy Starr had pulled on Manson the day that Terry Melcher left Spahn Ranch and never looked back. It had allegedly been one of the weapons that was stolen from the archery headquarters in El Monte, California on the night of March 12, 1969. Randy Starr claimed he had obtained the gun in a trade with a man named Ron, and remember that because we will come back to it later. Before they left, Tex and Susan dipped into their hidden stash of meth, and as they all piled into the car, Charlie allegedly told the girls to do everything that Tex told them to and to leave a sign that they'd been there, something witchy. Once again, allegedly. At this point, Tex Watson is the only one who knows what their mission is. The girls have no idea. They don't know, maybe they're in for another creepy crawly. They don't know what's going on, but they were told to bring their knives. And everybody had been talking about copycat murders in the days leading up to them going on this mission. So I have a hard time believing that these were just little naive girls who thought they were out for an innocent evening of home invasions. When they pulled up to the security gate of 10050 Cielo Drive, Tex got out and told the girls to stay in the car. He then took bolt cutters and he killed the power to the main house and the guest cottage. He then took the gun and some nylon rope and he motioned for the girls to exit the car and follow him. At that point, he told them, we're gonna go inside here and we're gonna murder everyone in there. They didn't act shocked. They didn't say no. They didn't run away and try to get help. They didn't run away to just escape. According to Pat Krenwinkle, they were little kitty cats. They were mentally gone and they'd been told to do everything that Tex told them to do. So they obeyed. That evening, Sharon Tate, Jay Sebring, Abigail Folger, and Wojtech Frokowski had been out to dinner together at El Coyote. Jay Sebring had called the restaurant earlier that day and made an 8 o'clock dinner reservation for him and the three others. After waiting about 15 minutes in the bar, the four of them were seated and unknowingly ate their last meals. They left around 9:45 p.m. and headed back to Cielo Drive. That same night, part-time caretaker William Gerritsen had hitched a ride up to Sunset Boulevard to get cigarettes and food and he hitchhiked back. When he got there, it was a little bit after 10 p.m. He saw Jay Sebring's Porsche parked in the driveway. Sharon Tate's Camaro was also there, and the Firebird that Abigail Folger drove. He went into the guest cottage and ate his dinner alone, but later that evening, he got an unexpected guest. Stephen Parent, 6-foot-tall, redheaded college student who was working 2 jobs to afford his education, and he had given Garrison a ride a few weeks prior to this night. He was trying to sell a clock radio he had for a few extra bucks. Steve Parent was pretty much a genius when it came to electronics. One of his part-time jobs was at an electronics store, and his sister said that he would often bring home clock radios and other electronics and pull them apart so he could see how they worked. He had remembered Garrison and giving him a ride back to Cielo Drive, so he thought maybe Garrison owned that home and he had money, and maybe he'd be interested in this clock radio he had to sell. He arrived at the guest cottage around 11:45 p.m. that evening, and he plugged the clock radio in to show Garrison how it worked. Garrison wasn't interested in the clock radio, but he did offer Steve Parent a drink. They had a beer together, they chatted. Steve Parent made a call to a friend from the cottage to meet up, and he unplugged the clock radio around 12:15 a.m. Garrison walked Steve Parent back to his Wrangler that was parked in the driveway, and as they walked, they heard Rudy Altobelli's dogs barking, which usually signified there was somebody walking around on the property. But Garrison wasn't alarmed by this because he had seen that Sharon Tate had guests, so there were people walking around on the property. Steve Parent got into his car and drove up to the electronic gates. As he rolled down the window to press the button to open the gates, he heard a voice yell, "Halt!" When Tex and the girls had been walking up the driveway to the house, they'd seen his headlights, so they'd jumped in the bushes to hide. But when he stopped at the gate to open it, Tex Watson emerged from the bushes, holding a gun in one hand and a knife in the other. According to Tex Watson, Steve Parent begged for his life. He said, "Please don't hurt me. I won't say anything." And he raised his arm defensively to block his face. And then, despite being given very specific instructions to not use the gun unless it was absolutely necessary, he shot the 18-year-old 4 times. Why did Tex Watson emerge from hiding to shoot Steve Parent, who was leaving and hadn't known that they were there? Was it because Manson had told him to kill everybody on the property and he couldn't disobey orders? But Manson had also given him very direct orders to not use the gun unless absolutely necessary. A kid who's leaving the property, doesn't know you're there, and is going to be gone in 2 seconds, doesn't seem like the kind of absolutely necessary, we need to protect ourselves situation. Or did Tex Watson kill Stephen Parent because Tex Watson is a killer? Tex Watson took the mission that Manson suggested to him because he wanted to, because he liked violence, because he wanted to kill people. Once Steve Parent was dead in the driver's seat, Tex reached in through the open window and shifted the car into neutral. Then he and the girls rolled it back up the driveway and left it parked there. The four of them made their way up to the main house where they could see Christmas lights twinkling on the fence, lights that Candace Bergen had strung there when she lived at the house with Terry Melcher, and Sharon Tate thought they were pretty, so she left them up. Inside the main house, the gunshots had gone unnoticed, as they had gone unnoticed in the guest cottage where Garrison was. The house is positioned in the canyon above Hollywood and Beverly Hills, made sound a tricky thing. Any sound that happened on the grounds, you could probably hear it miles down the canyon. But something that happened right there on the property might be hard to hear even just 100 feet away. The sound of the gunshots didn't go completely unnoticed by everybody, though. Mr. and Mrs. Seymour Knotts of 10070 Cielo Drive heard them. Mrs. Knotts thought she heard what sounded like 3 or 4 gunshots in quick succession coming from the direction of the driveway of 10050 Cielo Drive, Sharon Tate's residence. This was between 12:30 and 1 a.m., but when the couple heard nothing further, they decided to go back to sleep. Tim Ireland, a counselor who was supervising an overnight school camping trip, also heard some things. He was just about 3/4 of a mile south and downhill from the Polanski home, and he heard what sounded like a man screaming around 12:40 a.m. Inside the Cielo Drive home, Abigail Folger was in the guest bedroom. She was wearing a white nightgown and she was reading. Her boyfriend, Wojtech Frykowski, was asleep on the couch in the living room. And Sharon Tate and Jay Sebring were in the master bedroom chatting on the bed. Because of her advanced pregnancy and the oppressive heat in LA at this time, they were on the tail end of a 3-day heat wave. Sharon was only wearing her underwear and a gauzy sort of nightgown draped over her shoulders. Both Sebring and Wojtek Frykowski were fully dressed. Now, because of the way Sharon was dressed, there's often rumors in the future after the murders that Sebring and Sharon Tate had been having an affair, that they'd rekindled their romance. There are no facts to back this up. However, after her death, an actor named Christopher Jones came forward and admitted to having an affair with Sharon Tate when she was about 6 weeks pregnant. Polanski himself has admitted to having multiple affairs while married to Sharon Tate, one of them being with Michelle Phillips of the Mamas and the Papas. Of course, we all know that Roman Polanski isn't a stand-up guy. Facing 5 charges of statutory rape of underage girls from 1977 till today, he's even admitted to being attracted and drawn to younger girls in their teens. He says that all men are. They just don't say it or act on it. He's always tried to convince people that it's a natural thing, that what he's doing or what he's done, the way he feels, isn't abnormal at all. So basically, the man is and was a pedophile, and that's not really relevant to this story, but I wanted to bring it up because I know that if I talk about how much Roman loved his wife, because I do believe he loved her and cared about her, and I know he was devastated after her death, if I talk about how much he loved his wife, there's always going to be the people in the comments who are like, but he's a pedophile. Okay. I understand that he's a pedophile. I understand what has happened, but that is not this story. This is the story of Sharon Tate and what happened to her and her friends. And Roman plays a supporting character at best. I'm sure their marriage faced many problems and challenges, as often many marriages, if not all marriages, do. Basically, is it possible that Sharon Tate was having a relationship with Jay Sebring? Yes, but there's no evidence to support that theory. And I don't see why it would really matter. I don't see why people would judge Sharon Tate or Jay Sebring for that. The fact is, her husband was cheating on her often. She probably knew about it. Maybe they had that kind of marriage. Maybe they had that kind of relationship where they just agreed that they would see other people. Maybe they were swingers. We don't know what was going on, and we should not judge. And on that note, I'm going to end part 4 here. Thank you guys so much for watching. Thank you so much for sticking with me. If you're still here after all of these parts, after all of this time, thank you so much. You guys are the real MVPs, and you are very committed to seeing this through like I am. So thank you. Stay kind and stay beautiful. Love you. Bye.
She's like a sickness in my brain, a vision standing by the window pane. She ripples through the blinds and leaves me in a daze.